Good evening, and welcome to a Fireside Chat with me, Lance White, as the Zany Mystic. My book, The Tales of the Zany Mystic, is now available at Amazon.com. Please check it out. My guest tonight is David Warner. On July 27, 1987, David experienced an event that forever changed his life. During an out-of-body experience, he began in-depth documentation and scientific research into the out-of-body experience. He states, "It's definitely a gift from God to explore thousands of experiences which allow him to share his story." Today, he shares his experiences on radio shows and on the Internet. He's active in outreach programs and is a companion to the dying. So let's welcome David to the show now and find out more about these experiences. Hi, David. How are you?
I'm very good.
Good. I just wanted to tell you how I really enjoy hearing you on Mike Quincy's show. On the other, he has a show here at BBS.
Yeah.
And I just want to thank you for being with us tonight.
Yes. Hey, I appreciate the opportunity of being on your show, and I definitely look forward to this next hour.
Now, there might be some people out there who aren't familiar with an out-of-body experience, or OBE,
mm-hmm.
and maybe we could start by just kind of, you could explain what that is so that people understand what we're talking about.
Okay. Well, the out-of-body experience is just what it says. I mean, it's basically your consciousness separating from your physical body and stepping into the soul, or the spirit, or what's commonly known today as the astral body. It's making that shift from the physical into the spiritual body, and then once you make that separation and cross over, then you're able to experience the levels of the astral plane and higher.
Huh. I never thought of it that way. You just explained something that I never knew, that you're actually shifting your consciousness into your spirit body.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I had it all backwards. For some reason, I just imagined that you just leave your body. Some part of you leaves your body, but you're actually shifting your consciousness into your spirit body.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's a lot of, different schools of thought of the actual separation process. I mean, you could be still within your physical body and remote view or travel into the spiritual realms without even moving, or you could actually make that shift fully into the spiritual body and go about in that realm and be mobile and move. But I look at it more like just crossing a bridge.
Okay.
Going from a physical, material, solid substance into a energy, a radio frequency, tuning in and changing channels and making that shift into that body and then leaving.
Interesting. Now, I've recently had some guests who have shared their experiences of NDEs, or near-death experiences. Is there a big difference between the two?
Well, first of all, I have not had, the opportunity to have an NDE.
Okay.
And I really don't want to go down that road.
It sounds pretty dramatic.
Yeah, but I've had the opportunity to talk with some real great, folks on this, like Juliet Nightingale, a good friend Cougar out in the West and in Washington, and from what they've explained to me, there's just so many similarities of making that shift. We are multidimensional beings making that shift from physical into the spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
Now, some of the things that they've elaborated on is that there's a lot more activity happening and during the near-death experience versus an OBE in itself.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the reasons for that is that first of all, you're having that final moment physically due to a cardiac arrest, some kind of traumatic event, which you're just thrusted onto the other side.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, the higher beings that step in, the tunnel, love, you're raising those vibrations higher than as if you were to project in a OBE state that you project in a lower frequency, and it takes time to actually move into those realms, like a NDE-er would go up in a higher realm, and then assistance would be there to guide them further with that experience in itself. As for the OBE, you're starting on a lower level, and plus, the red flags are flying. This person is dying, so the higher beings, spiritual beings, whoever that experiencer witnesses at that time of death, that near-death experience, they come in at the aid and to help and to assist. And that's what my interpretation is when I have talked to these fine folks, and there's a lot more activity going on in the experience that, you know, compares and contrasts. I mean, there's a lot of variations that are there, but a lot of similarities of what we both, you know, what the OBE and the NDE-er experiences.
Well, that makes sense. Now it's going to get interesting. How would you like to tell us about your very first out-of-body experience and what happened?
Yeah, well, my real first conscious OBE experience, it took place back in 1987. I was at my friend's house, and he explained to me about out-of-body experiences, astral projection, which is commonly known as. So I asked my friend about, you know, reading material. He gave me a book, and then from there I just kept pursuing it and reading more on the subject and just asking everybody, family members, you name it, strangers, enemies, you name it, about out-of-body experiences. And everybody would look at me like, what? You know, lock them up.
Yeah.
But I just had some kind of calling, some kind of pull, some kind of in-depth feeling from somewhere that just, like, I have to know. And as my first experience took place within a couple months of coming across and being, you know, educated about the experience of the OBE, it actually took me 2 months to successfully project. And it was unexpected, because at the time I was trying to I was trying to bring forth the experience from a different avenue, and that was like through a dream approach, being in the dream, waking up and projecting from there. But it all occurred from the wide awake induced trance state, where that's the borderline between awakening and falling asleep. While your physical body is in that position right in the middle, then you have vibrations that come on, and then after that, then you can make that transition from physical into the spiritual. What happened to me, I was reading this book at the time, Janet Lee Mitchell. Loved the book, just couldn't put it down, but I needed to take a nap. I was tired. So I put the book down, but on my mind, it was just, I want to read this book. I want to read this book. So I turned the lights off down in the basement that I was at the time, decided to take a little nap, but on my mind, I want to read this book. So what do you think happens? I pop out of my body. I float up. I felt really drunk, out of it, but incredibly aware, alert, and conscious. And I was really confused. And it almost, the perception almost reminds me of, especially the first time, was drinking at least 3 or 4 beers and being in a real drunken but a high alert state of awareness and consciousness. And at the time, I did not know what was going on, and the first thing that popped on my mind, oh, I need to put my shoes on. I'm going to go walking across the floor. I don't want to get my feet cold or dirty. So as I kept putting on my shoes, I tried reaching for them, but my hand kept passing through my shoe. And I'm just thinking to myself, why is this happening? I got upset. I was mad. I was angry. I'm like, forget it. You know, I'm done with trying to put the shoe on. But it didn't register at that time that I was out of body. I mean, that's how solid, real, and concrete the consciousness was. It was just so high and level that I just did not know what was going on. So I decided to go for the book. I abandoned hope on the shoes and trying to put them on, and as I started drift about maybe 5 to 10 feet, I lost my balance, and then I started falling backwards, and then a whole deluge of thoughts started racing through my mind, And the first thing I could think of is, I'm falling backwards, I'm going to hit the bedpost, crack my skull open, there'll be blood everywhere, mom and dad will be paranoid and pissed off, or I mean really worried, and you know, they're going to have to rush me to the hospital. My brother is going to be pissed because he would have to clean up the bed and the blood on the floor and, and the sheets. So, you know, all at once, all these thoughts were just racing through my, at that moment in time. And as I came back, I slammed back so hard with vibrations, my chest, you know, beating 100 miles per hour. I'm just absolutely drenched in sweat, and it's complete darkness. In the basement room that I was at, and just absolutely perplexed what happened, and I did not know what happened until about 15, 20 seconds later as I bolted out of the room, running upstairs and then down the hallway, and it hit me like lightning that I had my first OBE, and I, you know, that day just really changed everything and how I kind of looked at life and where I was in that moment in time in my youth. And you know, realizing, you know, it's just not about me. I mean, I'm just like this little speck of, you know, energy, this little dust with, you know, thousands and millions of other people around me that, you know, I just don't care about. And, you know, I thought everything revolved around me until I had that first experience. And then it was a wide open awakening experience, very humbling and maturing me at a youthful age.
Wow. then it must have been quite a change for you in your life. And when did you have the next one? Did you actively pursue it then, or was?
Oh yeah. I've my second OB took place about within a week later, and then after that, I mean, once I had that first one, it's like I was set on fire. I got to have it again. I got to learn more.
Wow.
And then, I mean, I read as much material I could get my hands on that was available at the time. You know, I would actually go on computer boards known as BBS boards back in the old days. You know, where we had 300 to 1200 baud modem.
And yeah.
Kids' days now, what? Modem? Apple IIe? That's like olden days. You know,
yeah, I remember.
But, yeah, I mean, I just, in anything on the subject that I could learn about and communicate with other people, you know, I was just so, I was just very driven. I had that thirst for it. I wanted to know. I wanted to learn more. I wanted to be able to take that OBE to a level to where I'm going to do it every week or every day. It's not going to be random by chance. And as I started pursuing it, within about 6 months to a full year, I got it up to a level to where I could do it almost weekly.
Wow.
And then after the last 20 years, as I kept pursuing the OBE, now I can do it on a weekly basis at least two or three times. And I have this all documented statistically, and the data's there. And it's just, it's a beautiful experience that is definitely a gift. It's a calling from a higher spiritual, and what, you know, we call God, giving to me to be able to share this information, and realizing, you know, the OB is just one little small part of it. But once you step on the spiritual side, there's so much to learn to bring back to the physical side, and to help others and share the information. So I've been chasing this for the last 20 years, and it's just a blessing to be able to do this.
Wow. Well, definitely sounds like this is something that you had chosen to do before you, if you believe in incarnations, that, you know, we set things up in advance that we, you know, want to explore while we're here. And it sure sounds like something that might have been like that.
Yeah, you know, I've thought about that. I'm, you know, I've never really had any past life reading or, you know, been put into like a hypnotized trance, you know, and regressed back. Eventually, I like to try that, see what happens.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's just everybody has their different feelings in life, and this is just something that is just so strong. I'm, again, it's like I just have a passion that just keeps burning. I want to be able to learn and to be able to bring this information and share it and help others, and, you know, that's what I've been set out to do.
I've heard that some people say that the out-of-body experiences mainly take place in some level of the fourth dimension or the astral plane, which is what you just said.
Mm-hmm.
And there are higher planes than that, the fifth and so on and so forth. Does your experience validate this, and what's it like over there?
Well, you know, the lower level, which is called the astral plane, you know, there's a lot of different theories, fourth dimension, fifth dimension, focus 27. I try not to get all wrapped up into the theoreticals of, you know, how to tell what level you're on.
Okay.
You know, there's no, like, sign welcoming, hey, welcome to the fourth dimension. You now can, unseat your seatbelt. Yeah, you're free to roam the, but no, from what I've seen and in my experiences, vibrations, energy, and love really make a difference when you first start off on a lower level, which is, you know, called the astral plane.
Uh-huh.
And the lower level is very close to the physical. It's a mirrored, burned image of our past, present, and future.
Huh.
And you're basically omnipresent everywhere in that moment in time.
Huh.
And though you do have representations of buildings, houses, everything that looks just like a physical planet would be.
Huh.
Now, as you start moving into the higher plane levels, and as I said, you know, again, just tuning into that frequency, especially love, that's the most purest thing that you can tune into to go into the higher planes.
Mm-hmm.
Then you start seeing that physical part melt away.
Mm.
And some of the environments that I've been into where, like, making that shift from that astral into the higher planes,
mm-hmm.
like example, in one experience, the physical to the higher level, I would be traveling into a field of like a world just covered in all different types of colors. They looked like diamonds shining.
Huh.
Okay, all beautiful little colors look like diamonds.
Huh.
And as I moved through that into the higher level, I had found myself in a courtyard, and I was met by angelic beings.
Huh.
And, I mean, I'm just, you know, really briefly summarizing this experience, but as I had sat around this table and looking at these angels, you know, one angel's on my right and one's in front of me, I would look in the distance and I would see like a mountain with like a stream of water flowing down, and I could see the details of the pine trees.
Huh.
and then the marbles of the stones of this whole courtroom that I was outside, and as I looked upward, then I would see like colors of different of energy, of just whizzing all around me.
Oh.
It was just one of those experiences where you just, you know, you break out in tears and just say, this is just the most beautiful thing I've ever seen in my life.
Wow.
You know, I've also traveled in different experiences with help of an angel through the tunnel and being broken into a whole world of just pure white light, blinding, but very clear, clean, very brilliant and majestic, loving light.
Mm.
And that's just, you know, on that emotional part of it, is just, you know, you can feel the differences between the different levels and the vibrations as you go from lower into the higher realms. And I tell you, it's just, it's awesome.
Wow. Maybe you could talk a little bit more about that experience. Would you consider that was like your guardian angel, or just somebody that was a being of light that was just happened to be there, or was it like a guide? And what was it like in those realms?
The very first experience was about a year and a half or so ago, and I'll be very brief. This was my first encounter with an angel, and I wanted to be able to move into the higher plane levels, and I had opportunities in previous projections But what would happen is I would abort at certain times when I would be trailing off into the distance, and the physical would be, you know, moving away from a material, you know, structure into a more of a finer, coarse, fluid, you know, non-descriptive physical world.
Okay.
And sometimes I would be nervous, a little fearful.
Uh-huh.
There'd be a roadblock, and that would actually cause me to abort the actual experience.
Okay.
And then, you know, I would come back, and then I would be thinking to myself, why did I do that? And it's just something in previous attempts, as I failed, there were different people at different times right there to help me, and I would bail on that attempt.
Yeah.
So in this experience, I remember I was in the front yard of my mom and dad's house, and about 80-90% of the time of my experiences, they start at my parents' home.
Okay.
It's kind of like my www home address on the astral plane, World Wide Web. And it's just a comfort. It's like my little starting point, my shrine to start off.
Okay.
So the experience started where I was at my mom and dad's house. I was on the front lawn, and I'm just like on my knees praying, and I'm just thinking, you know, I've failed as many times as in the past. Can somebody give me a hand here? And then as I looked off to my right by a house through the trees, I saw a angel materialize, kind of like a transparent liquid image coming through the trees and then taking shape and form. And as she landed, she was in front of me. She had the wings, very majestic, very detailed, a little black between the feathers, and just white, no halo or anything like that. I can't remember exactly about the detail of the clothes, but I think it was like a blue silk type like linen cloth or silk dress-like, but she had brown hair. I would say she was probably late 40s, tan, and she had a presence to her that of concern. And as I'm looking at her, you know, my jaws dropped open wide. I'm stunned and believe, because I never had something like that just, you know, pop into my radar, right on my view.
And, right.
You know, I didn't say anything, and she just took off. So I'm thinking to myself, well, I could either follow her or I could abort this experience. So I decided to test this spirit being, this angel. And I asked her, as I started chasing after her, flying after her, I says, are you God? And she says, no, everyone from, you know, from the tiny virus to the edges of the universe to what we see here, and on the other side, everybody is God.
Wow.
That's who we all encompassed are. Everybody's God, and God is experiencing every single, everything that is made, God experiences.
Wow.
All the time, consistently.
Ooh.
And as we kept going, I asked, the angel asked me, are you okay? And I said, yes, I think I can do this time. And as I kept going with this angel, she kept asking me at different times if I was comfortable with what she was showing me.
Mm-hmm.
And in previous experiences that I bumped into, like lower level of people who are unconscious or thought forms or entities, they just would not be as on cue. I mean, really tight, you know, cut to the chase. This is what I'm going to show you. Mm-hmm. Learn. The other lower inhabitants of the astral plane are just more like dreamish. Do they just go along unconscious and just random mumblings? And this gal, she was right on the money. She just cut to the chase. So we started drifting off into, I would say, it kind of reminded me of a blue pool liquid being submerged underwater, trailing off into a great distance. And I could feel my vibrations and energy change, and she was showing me something that looked like, I thought at the time, hard to explain, but it kind of resembled like a fetus,
huh,
to a baby. And she kept asking me, are you okay with this? And then from there, that's when we started going through the tunnel.
Oh.
And then we broke into the light. And again, she asked me, are you okay with this? And I'm like, yes, let's do this. I can do it.
Uh-huh.
And I remember I was seeing everything, a scene of me demonstrating something physical, some kind of meeting or explaining some kind of technical, something with computers, because that's my profession. I'm an IT consultant.
Uh-huh.
And I remember I was around a group, and I was seeing everything, you know, like one big panoramic view of like a 360, everything I could see, front, face, back,
wow,
up, down, all around, all the time.
Huh.
And then I asked the angel, I'm like, is everything recorded? And she explained to me everything from physical to spiritual rebirth to physical death to here, there, and after. And I remember saying to myself, oh, S-H-I-T, during that experience. And I'm thinking, duh, I'm sorry. And she said to me specifically, that's okay, but that's something that you can work on. Be a lot vulgar in your vocabulary and in physical. I mean, she didn't say that, but there was a jovial tone in her, but she did say that's something that you can work on. Now, after that whole experience, you know, was over, and I'm just hitting more like the highlights of that.
Uh-huh.
And you know, if I was to really get into it, we'd be probably talking about it for a good hour of the details of what went on. But as I did come back from that first experience, I was absolutely just moved from it, because I never had something like that happen.
Uh-huh.
And I actually incorporated that in my everyday language, in removing, you know, swear words from my vocabulary, and just trying to present myself a little bit more professional. And I think a lot of that has to do with what I'm doing on the radio,
uh-huh,
and presentations, and who I work for, and also working with hospice patients. You know, it just, that does creep up, and if I can nip that in the bud, I mean, who am I to argue with an angel? So, you know,
yeah.
Don't get me wrong, there's every now and then I will slip up, especially when there's pain involved,
yeah,
but, you know, it's, yeah, something that, it was a lesson that, you know, I learned from her, and again, who am I to argue with an angel?
Well, you know, it's funny because I've all the accounts I've read recently and the experiences that other people have shared about their experiences indicate that there is a life review, and that you're able to see, not that you're able to, but that's how you see it. You see your life from your own perspective, and then you see it from the perspective of the people that you've affected negatively and positively without judgment. And then you see it from an omniscient experience, and so you're simultaneously viewing it from three different views.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that information alone seems to me like it would be life-changing information about how we do things on this side. If you knew that everything was being recorded, and that you're going to have to watch every thought and every emotion and every person that you've affected, you know, during your lifetime, at some future date, it seems like that would change people's lives.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I mean, I'll tell you the honest to God truth. Just listening to those experiences has made me think a lot about, you know, how I present myself and, you know, how I might want to think back on myself in the future.
Mm-hmm.
So on and so forth. It's a strange thought, but it makes a lot of sense.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, you've had other experiences with the angel, is that correct? Or
yes, I have, and that was like the one I narrated a little bit earlier about being in the courtyard and seeing,
yeah,
the distance, and you know, just coming back from those experiences. I mean, that first one, I was absolutely in complete tears, and I remember at the time, not just only that, you know, I narrated my experience right away. Normally when I return from the other side, I have my pocket PC, and I'll just narrate, you know, the experience, so that way it's fresh in my mind.
Yeah, yeah, that's remember, a good idea.
And not let, you know, the physical take over and start trying to, you know,
right,
add in the missing blank.
Right, right.
But I mean, at the time, my wife and I, we were talking about doing foster care or foster adoption, and I was a little kind of resistant to that. And after that experience of just, you know, being in the presence of that angel, I started to really reflect a little bit more on that. And I, you know, I approached my wife. I said, let's do this. I mean, I, you know, there's a lot more to that, you know, than just, you know, the 9 to 5, punch the time clock, and, you know, right now that's what we're doing. We are foster care mentors, and so far it's been a very rewarding experience, not just for us, but for, the, you know, the gal that we are helping, and it's a lesson. Those are lessons from those spiritual beings, and we are a creature of habit. So we need to learn these things to, you know, be better, not just to ourselves, but everybody around us. And, you know, that can promote better energy. And you know, if somebody sees us doing this and we explain our story, then we can get more people involved.
Well, that sounds like a nice idea. Does it seem like the veils between the worlds, the different energies might be thinning to allow more people to have these experiences?
I think more of the people that have these experiences are the ones that are during near death.
Yeah.
But, you know, people are able to catch windows of this during a dream. Because, you know, you do have some of the people that come back and say, I had deja vu experience, and this happened, you know, a few weeks ago, and this actually happened, a few weeks later. A lot of that can be where people are, you know, kind of tired, and you're drowsy, and you drift off a little bit, and you start to separate, but you're unconscious, and from there, you quickly snap back, and you feel like those little tingles, and you just feel that little awkwardness, that emptiness, and then returning back to the physical body. That's another sensation of that. It's just really becoming conscious of it, and practicing and training and tuning into it. You know, I've seen in my research and my studies on this is that I look at it at, you know, three different ways of being able to enter to the other side, and that's one through the dream. The second one would be through a false awakening, which, you know, we are awakening up like in the dream, but we're actually awakening up, you know, on the spiritual side and not realizing it, carrying on our physical task at hand, like waking up in the morning, brushing our teeth, combing our hair, then going outside, turning on the car, getting to work, and as you reach the door, you wake up, back in your bed. That's another one. The last one would be basically watching yourself fall asleep. You briefly let go, and then you return while your physical body is in between that, you know, that the threshold. And then between that state to where you can make that conscious projection, you know, from beginning to all the way to that projection and then returning. And that's what I've been favorably been able to do. I've documented this statistically for the last 3 years seriously, and that's where the numbers show that that's where I'm more fluent in. Now, like with the dream part of it, as I was saying, you know, with people, you know, catching, you know, windows of it, it's just basically breaking out of that unconscious dream bubble and realizing that you are there and that we do absorb things, bounce off of us in that dream bubble that we do catch. It's just, we just got to learn how to break out of it and interpret these things.
Do you feel that, I mean, were you ever able to meet any of your relatives, and how did they appear to you if you did?
Yes. A few years ago, I met my grandmother and my uncle. They had passed on, my grandmother passed on in, it was like about a month before 2000, the year. And my uncle, he had passed on 92, 93. What had happened, again, I was at my mom and dad's house, and I'm out on the front lawn, and I just remember I'm like laying on my stomach, and I'm just trying to crawl. And I just remember getting on my feet, and I was going into the house. And this is, I know this is going off on a different spin here, but I will lead eventually back to your question.
Okay.
But, you know, the one part which is interesting is that you can be in the OBE, but while you're in that OBE and you're fully conscious, you can have a daydream flight of what you create, but you can still be where you are in that moment, in that time, in the astral, but you can still be in that daydream flight of what you want to create. Like, you and I are talking right now.
Uh-huh.
You're imagining all this other stuff that's going on, but you're still there in your seat. But you can still do that on the other side. So what I think happens is that people that are dreaming are in that daydream flight, but they're just unconsciously moving about. So getting back onto that experience, that's what had happened to me. And as I snapped back, I had found myself at my mom and dad's house, and then as I started moving through different areas, I had found myself in an attic. I'm laying on the bed, I'm waking up, and I'm like thinking, what's going on here? And, you know, I'm thinking, well, I must just be up physically.
Uh-huh.
You know, the experience is over, and as I'm looking over on my right side, my grandmother's there.
Huh.
And I'm just talking with her, and I'm like putting two to two slowly together. I'm like, wait a minute, you had passed on in 1999, and I'm talking with you. Oh, grandmother, how you doing? And we embraced. I definitely felt the love, and I was all teary-eyed, and
no.
I asked how she was doing, and she was doing real good. She was younger. She was probably 30s, 40s, very full of life, as I had seen when she was younger, pictures in her youthful days. I tested that my grandmother, who I was seeing, and I just wanted to make sure. A lot of times during those experiences, statically, when you look at an object or a person, look away two, three different times and look back at the person to see if they change shape or shift their appearance.
Mm-hmm.
And it was static. And then from there, as I kept looking closer, then I was able to see the aura and the energy surrounding around her.
Mm-hmm.
And then I knew, bingo, I'm seeing the real thing.
Uh-huh.
And as I was talking with her, I had noticed the person that was next to her sitting on a chair. It was my uncle. And again, did the same whole thing, you know, the whole reunion. I love you, missed you, hope you're doing great, blah, blah, blah. And then I did the same thing. I looked at my uncle. They had the energy around him.
Oh.
It was just a very moving experience. And as the experience started to end, my grandmother was pointing at this box that was on this third chair. And I didn't open the box or anything like that, and I lost my conscious awareness and my energy, and I came back to the body.
Okay.
So I narrated everything down. I explained everything to my family and my friends and my aunt. And basically, when my grandmother, when she was younger and to her older days and with her grandchildren and everything, she was always a gift giver.
Huh.
And we came down to the conclusion that it was a gift. Because she was, you know, when she was younger and through her older years, she didn't have a lot of money, but if she always enjoyed giving gifts. It could be a balloon, it could be like a Kiss album, or it could be a doll, or it could be a bunny or Easter basket.
Huh.
She always enjoyed giving gifts, and that she was pointing to me. We believe and feel that it was a representation of a gift, showing that and validating her personality that she was in physical form,
right.
In spiritual form.
That would make sense. So it sounds like you're, from your own experiences, that you are pretty convinced, if not totally convinced, that we do continue on in spirit form and or in consciousness, and that we don't, you know, that we don't die when the physical body dies.
Oh, definitely. I mean, it's more or less just, again, as I said, you know, shifting consciousness
mm-hmm.
into
mm-hmm.
that spiritual body. You know, we are multidimensional beings.
Mm-hmm.
And what's really validating to my experiences is that the tracking that I have done on validations, let alone Now, I mean, you can argue so much about, you know, being skeptic, but once you start tracking this data, and normally for me, I'm very passive, relaxed, and I'm not the brightest of people. When I'm on the other side, I just let the experience happen, and I do not, you know, try to coax or force or try to look for a validation. It just happens where it's right on the mark. There is no symbolic message where I have to have, you know, have to answer a riddle to get to the meeting. It's straight cut to the chase. This is here, and this is how it is.
Mm-hmm.
And as I come back and validate the information, it is just absolutely to the point where you start putting the numbers down, and after 50, 60, 70, some validations on a monthly basis, that little skepticism starts, you know, or the lack of the skepticism and the faith and the validation and improving this starts moving more towards the right, that needle, and you move farther away from that skeptic part.
Uh-huh.
And remember, this is all personal experiences where, I mean, I could talk to you until the cows come home about all my validations, all my experiments that I've done, but, you know, the person that really needs to validate for themselves is the person that is wanting to project and to know more about it, and being open to the possibility of it existing. You don't have to take everything on 100% faith and just, you know, this is it. But if you really want to do the work and plug away out of it and have the desire and the thirst for it, you will find it. It will come. But it comes over time, wisdom, and patience, and really just, you know, opening up basics on your intent and what you really want from it.
You know, I don't want people, the listeners, to get the idea that this is entirely all love and light either. You've had some harrowing experiences too in all of the positive ones, haven't you?
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, that's how we learn. I mean, what was it, just the other day I was on the AstroPulse forum, and I frequently visit there, and I'm a moderator, and, you know, I try to answer many questions, and somebody was asking something about, you know, the other side, and, hey, are we immortal on the other side? Will we die? And so on. And I've told the person in the post, you know, I've been burnt, I've been choked to death, I've been shot, I've been stabbed, I've been, you know, impaled, and everything else. I've been just, you know, I got my butt kicked, I got, you know, my throat slit, everything else, burnt on fire, and, you know, I'm still here. The only thing that really separated that moment in that time is just the mental part of it. And realizing, wait a minute, okay, yeah, fear is definitely there. Don't get me wrong, the next time I go out, you know, and I touch the electrical wire and I get zapped, and, you know, don't think I'm still going to be nervous, because I will be nervous, but it is a mechanism in ourselves that, you know, hey, danger, Will Robinson, don't touch the burner. And, you know, you touch it, you get burned. But that's how we learn through experience, and we have to that is there for us to learn from. An example like that, the angel in going into the higher levels and what she was, you know, showing me, I had to test, hey, are you of God? And that's why we have to be diligent. We have to validate our experiences, but we also have to be intelligent and educate ourselves to recognize, hey, this is not legitimate, and this is. And this is why we have to work at it to really fully understand, you know, the good and the bad, and not just taking everything on faith. Because if we took everything on faith, then why even try?
Exactly.
I'll just wait till I die, and that's it. But, you know,
exactly.
You know, it's just something that you got to really work at, you know. You're bound to happen. I mean, you can step outside in the physical world and somebody shoots you.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, except that then you'd have a near death, you'd have a death experience.
Yeah, there you go. You know?
You'll have it firsthand, only you won't be able to come back.
Yeah.
Speaking of God, it's, I know everybody, that's kind of like the big question, you know. You mentioned earlier that the angel said that every virus, everything is God, and God's experiencing everything. Did you ever get a sense that there was something that was separate, that, you know, was like the God, or that was closer to what your concept of God was, or is that so far removed from our everyday experience that we can't really experience that directly?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think we will be able to understand or even comprehend of what God, the knowledge and, the truth is.
Right, right.
You know, the NDEers who come back about it, and the most, as they describe the love, the peace, and everything that they've been, hit with information, and when they try to bring it back down and, assess and try to interpret physical, it's the same thing.
Yeah.
You know it at the time, and you experience it, and I get that a lot on the other side. It's like, I know it. I can understand it. It's an emotional thing. But I when I try to bring back to the physical, I just can't express it.
It doesn't translate well.
Yeah. And, maybe I need like a foreign astral entity medium translator. I don't know. But, I think God is just, encompasses everything.
Yeah.
I don't look at God as a man on a throne with a long gray beard. I think of God as everything, living, breathing, invisible, virus, and just experiencing itself on multiple levels.
Yeah.
Every second.
Yeah, yeah.
And to even touch that, that'd be awesome,
Well, yeah, it sounds like your experiences don't contradict or negate any kind of religious belief. I know that sometimes people who are, I'm not particularly religious, but I know there are a lot of people who tend to, view this kind of experience as, this is of the devil, or this is this or that or the other thing. But it sounds like it's very complementary.
Mm-hmm.
Is what would you say?
Well, I grew up Christian, and I still am, and I'm active in my church, and I attend church every week Sunday.
Okay.
And when I first approached this with my pastor, and believe it or not, at the time, my wife, when I explained to her about my experiences and everything, and, the first thing she jumped at is like, oh, my God, this is just the devil's work, just because she's got, Satan and taking her on the wrong path, and I'm afraid for you, but, I want to protect you.
Uh-huh.
And I'm thinking to myself, I've been doing this for almost 20-some years now, and, I've been, I've had the good experiences and the bad experiences.
Right, and you're still alive.
Yes, I'm still alive. Now, the thing is that as I talked to my pastor about this, I explained everything.
Uh-huh.
I didn't hold back. I told him everything. And he says, you have a good heart, and you've learned from it, and it is all based on your intent.
Yeah.
There's a billion ways to find God.
Yes.
And there is no right or wrong to it.
Yes, absolutely.
As long as it's a positive way to it. I mean, if you're going off killing people, I'm going to get to God.
Right.
And
there's something wrong with that picture.
Yeah, there's a big, there's a big roadblock with that one. But, hey, if I am educating myself about my faith and my religion and expanding my awareness, and these experiences come to me to become a better person to the community through my church or through my hospice work or being a foster mentor or being a provider for a home,
mm-hmm.
and a loving relationship and a faithful husband and helping the people in the global community. I mean, how can you debate that, saying that's an evil entity, force, Satan, telling me to go into the darkest areas and holding people's hands because they're dying of cancer?
Well,
you can't. I'm there. I'm there for you.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
As you learn more about the different religions and the different faiths, it just perplexes me why we are fighting for, the one religion that
supremacy,
is...
Supremacy, yeah.
And all.
Yeah, it's
and
crazy.
Wait a minute, God is more than we could even imagine or fathom. I mean, I've read the Bible from beginning to the very end.
Uh-huh.
It's a very beautiful book. There's great values and morals and ethics that we can learn from.
Yeah, yeah.
But there's a lot of analogies that I see, symbolic analogies that I see that, you know, this is how we can explain this to a certain, you know, to a certain audience that can interpret it better,
uh-huh.
as like Judaism or the Quran with Islam,
mm-hmm.
or the religion
mm-hmm.
of the Native Americans. I've been studying these different religions, and they all report to, you know, a higher being.
Yeah, absolutely.
And just because we call that being Allah or God or the great spirit ego,
yeah,
it's just the different faiths, the different interpretations, and if we could respect each other's religions and not judge because that person burns sage and, you know, inhales a peace pipe to, you know, connect
exactly.
with God.
Exactly.
It's education.
I so agree with you on that. I'm really glad that you shared that with everybody, too. There's a question I'm kind of curious about. I didn't see any of it in any of your writings on the Internet.
Okay.
Did you, and this is a little bit off the wall, but in your experiences in traveling on that side, did you ever see anything or meet up with anything that you would consider was extraterrestrial in nature?
Like, you know, UFOs and, like...
Yeah, or like, you know, the greys or reptilians or some different kind of life form that's in those dimensions.
I remember, I've had different various experiences where I see something like a lizard-like human.
Hmm.
I've seen, like, different entities where, remember one time I woke up, I'm in bed, I'm on the other side, and this entity was grabbing, choking me to death, saying take my hand, become one of us, and I'm looking at complete darkness with a robe, you know, cloth over the face and green eyes, and I'm like, I don't think so. And I remember seeing like a blobish of light pressing me down into the carpet where I just could not move, and I just remember like that energy floating kind of like greenish, bluish above me.
Ooh.
Other times I've seen and actually felt, I was out in front of my parents' house, and it was like a picker bush, or like a tree, like, but it didn't have any leaves on it, more kind of like a mountain ash, but more like a bush where you'd see something that would spring in the summer, or the spring in the summer, and then it would just die, but you would just have like, it was kind of like in shape, where it was walking, almost like a human shape.
Huh.
You could see the different branches, and as I got closer to it, it attacked me and just took its, you know, branches and just impaled right into me.
Oh, yikes.
So, you know, that's one of those experiences where it's like, okay, yes, the fear is there, I'm scared, you know, click my magic shoes and, you know, place
get your
like
ruby
home,
slippers
please.
And...
yeah, my ruby slippers.
No place like home.
Like home, please, you know. But, yeah, I mean... You know, I've had experiences at different times where I've briefly seen like a like a UFO.
Oh, okay.
I remember one experience particularly as I started raising my vibrations and going higher and then transcending out into space. I remember being by a city that looked kind of futuristic, kind of like a George Lucas futuristic.
Oh, yeah,
stuff.
Yeah.
And then I would see like kind of like pyramid-shaped buildings and like little cars, like space cars floating above, whizzing back and forth below.
Wow.
And my energy was very low at that time because I wanted to explore and see what was going on, but I lost it. But I got enough good glimpse where I know I wasn't, you know, physical, earthbound. I was way out there.
Well, you know, speaking of being way out there, we're way out there, almost at the end of the show now. It's gone by so fast. Would you tell people how to get to your website and so on and so forth before we sign out?
Yeah, definitely. My website is Invisible Light, and that's based on my personal experiences, bibliography, and my journal notes, statistics, everything. Video, documents, at least a good 60, 70 hours of audio, video, narration material, you name it, it's there. The web address is www.invisiblelight.us.
Okay. Well, David, I thank you for being a guest on the show tonight. You were wonderful, and I enjoyed it immensely. We'll have to have you back again and find out some more about these experiences.
Thank you, Lance, and I definitely welcome the opportunity to coming back, and appreciate it. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thanks much, and good night to everybody, and good night, David.
Good night, Lance.
Bye-bye.